Harper Via and Harper Audio present Hula, a novel by Jasmin Iolani Hakes, performed by Mapuana Makia. For Rihanna, Mila, Mom, and Katrina, and the dance we dance, and for Hilo, where the heart beats loud and clear. Hula is the language of the heart, therefore the heartbeat of the Hawaiian people. King David Kalakaua. Verse 1. Ho'omaka. We are not what you think. To you who come on airplanes, who descend upon us, we are invisible as air. We are the aina and the sum of its parts, mauka and makai, past and present. Born of its waters, we are haumana and kupuna, ageless and ancient, the keepers of the stories, the watchers, the listeners. You think you've been here. You think you know us. You have the pictures to prove it. The pictures are wrong. You've seen nothing at all. We are not here for you. We were here before you came and will be here when you leave. We are Hilo, one. We are we. Back in the old days, you introduced yourself by telling your mo'o ku'auhau, where you was from, who's your dad, your grandma, your relations. Your mo'o ku'auhau told the story of where you fit, of your talent and ability, as well as your particular kuleana, the responsibilities and duty that contribute to the whole like a star in the sky. It said if you were of the mountain or of the ocean, it rooted you to your place. The Naupaka Ohana was one of Hilo's first families, both creator and protector of Keaukaha, our land, our home. Our jagged coastline was stamped into the veins of the Naupaka women. Laka, her mother, Hulali, her great tutu ulu, their collective mana ran through the crisp, fresh water gurgling up out of the black lava rocks along the shore and in the whispers of the hala groves. Everybody knew the story of the Naupaka Ohana, of where they'd come from, of everything they'd done for Keaukaha and Hilo. Theirs was the hula of us, the telling of not only how they became they, but how we became we. Like a mo'o ku'auhau, Star Chart's map weighs both forward and backward. With them, we find our way through the dark. We cross great oceans, we make our way home to Hilo. With the Naupakas, we knew the canoe would stay on course. Like any ohana, there are many roots and branches to the Naupaka tree, many ripples in the water of each Naupaka spring. But this one, Hii's story, was different. Her star chart was full of clouds. It muddied the waters of our history and left our future uncertain, our direction unknown. Hilo, Big Island's heart, land of the kanilehua rain, the mists from which the red lehua flowers drink. Hilo, our curse and our blessing. Chapter 1, 1968. When Hii was a baby, we blamed her color on sunscreen. We are the color of curly koa, of burnt butter, of empty beer bottles forgotten on the porch from the night before. Our rainbow is made up of browns, greens, blues. Our keiki roamed free. They tumbled naked on the same black sands of Richardson's that we'd tumbled free and naked on. Here, tucked away in our quiet, overlooked corner, the world made sense. But Hii's skin made her mother Laka do things only tourists do. That babe, so different from her mama, stayed parked under the shade of a palm tree, buried in hats and coveralls in Laka's arms, slathered from ear to toe in sunscreen so thick the ocean didn't know what to do with her. Kekai bounced her on its vast blue glittering surface, a pink conch baby buoy. We itched to get our hands on that babe, the next in line of the great Naupakas, a true daughter of our neighborhood, finally returned to take her place. We wanted to strip off her clothes and wipe her free of all those chemicals, to hold her up to the sun and let her bake. But Laka stayed hunched over her baby, alert, anxious, like she was trying to keep a bubble from popping. She spread her towel on the sand on the other side of the beach as if we were contagious. We kept our questions tied to our tongues, dogs on chains. The sky was bone dry, and the moon winked bright on the night the muddy gravel driveway off Kalani'ana'ole Street filled with rusted cars toddling on spare tires and with cracked windows. We extracted ourselves from cluttered back seats along with the foil-covered pans full of noodles for long life, lomi salmon and poi brought up fresh from the valley, taco poke, rice still steaming hot in the pot, and all the other poo-poos expected of a party. Six packs clinked their way into the coolers on the porch, waiting with open arms and melting ice. The fish, caught and cleaned that morning, were salted and laid out on the hibachi to hiss and sizzle and fill the air with a smell that made the tourists driving by wish they were invited. The warped plywood floor creaked and strained under the weight of what was becoming a very heavy party. On the porch, cigarette smoke exhaled in an upward tilt toward the current of breeze that had danced its way across Hilo Bay and into the yard. Hands, the kind accustomed to manual labor, waved at the wispy tendrils if they dared linger. We wanted to welcome her home. But Laka was skittish, a flight risk. We didn't want her to leave again. We got as close as we dared. We tiptoed, we teased. But into those waters, we never went deeper than our ankles. We whispered. It's what happens when you move Maui and like Bihai Maka Maka. When you work in the hotels with all the haole. The long, narrow length of dirt that served as Puhi Bay's parking lot was already full. Laka fitted her car between two trucks, both with jerry-rigged lifted suspensions, their bodies towering a full foot above their oversized tires as if floating on air. She stared for a minute, puzzled. Had this existed before she left? How quickly things change.
Eh, how's it, stranger?
She heard someone call from a distance. She waved in the direction of the voice and then turned away, not quite ready. She took her time rummaging in the back seat, gathering the accessories that were now her life. Diaper bag, changing blanket, sunshade, and a squirming, fussy baby who was not happy about being stuffed in a hot car at what was usually her nap time. A passing car stopped in the middle of the road.
Excuse me, hey, the driver called through the open window of the car.
Laka turned, catching the small Hertz rental sticker on a corner of the windshield.
Is this some kind of event or something?
Laka glanced toward the crowded grassy hill behind her and shook her head. No, this was very much a private party. The driver was about to ask her something else, never mind the cars piled up on the road behind him, all trying to be polite and not honk. She hurried away before he could say another word. School had broken for summer only a week ago, but the tent city at Puhi Bay was already in full swing. Lines strung between trees were straining under heavy wet towels and freshly rinsed pareos. Sleeping bags spilled out from the doors of ransacked tents, the result of kids changing which tent they crashed in every night after pillaging leftovers off the long tables full of aluminum foil-covered trays in the main tent, swimming with the moon and doing who knows what else. Laka remembered it well. Some things didn't change. She took a deep breath and followed the salty smell of roasting fish and chicken toward the fire. The uncles waved their stainless steel tongs in greeting before returning to the cooking meat on the grill, her father among them. He offered her a sad, soft smile, but did not approach her. After a moment, he turned his back. Expecting as much did not lessen the sting. She wanted to run to him and bury herself in one of his bear hugs, wanted to tell him she understood why he was doing what he was doing, wanted to tell him that she understood and forgave him. Instead, she kept her distance. Her youngest sister popped into her periphery, running with a herd of kids towards someone handing out popsicles, but Laka no longer knew how to call for siblings or draw them close. She had walked away from that privilege, and maybe there was no getting it back. She also did not bother looking for her mother. Laka had it on good authority that she wasn't there, which was the only reason she'd allowed the magnet of home to pull her in today. In the kitchen tent where meals were prepared en masse, she lashed the baby to her chest using an old pareo and set to work slicing a head of cabbage. She earned a few nods and kissed a few cheeks.
No one said anything, but she could feel the stares and stiffness, the uncomfortable politeness. When the baby fussed, a girl of about 14 came and asked to take it. The girl pointed in the direction of the large group of keiki playing in the tide pools. Laka put a protective hand around the baby and pressed it closer to her body, shaking her head as nicely as she could. When it was time for the baby to nurse, she returned to the car instead of joining the semicircle of folding chairs full of women, keeping an eye on the kids jumping off the rocks, cannonballs hitting the water below in loud splashes. On the way, she ran into her eldest brother. He introduced her to his girlfriend, who was so hapai her belly looked like an overblown balloon, but he did not go so far as to kiss Laka on the cheek or hug her or greet her as his sister returned. She didn't feel ready for this, but did not know how to leave. Later, when everyone's opus were full moons, stuffed with that night's dinner, out came the ukuleles. This was it, Hawai'i at its best. A showcase of undiscovered master performers, a row of grand kupuna telling stories, aunties playing cards, kids half-naked running around free as birds, not a television or tear in sight. Tribe, ohana, where there was always enough for everyone, never an empty seat at the table, but always an extra chair just in case. Laka closed her eyes and watched with her ears, this lullaby of her life. She wasn't sure if her father was still there, but he felt near. That counted as progress. The melody changed tune, calling to her, inviting her to join. There was no way she could listen to Na Pana Kaulana O Keo Kaha by beloved Auntie Edith Kanaka Ole and not let the song flow through her body. The ukulele singing its rhythm swayed back and forth like hala in the wind. The lyrics gave love to their Keo Kaha beaches, kissing each one in turn. The baby was sleeping, there was no excuse. She allowed herself to be drawn in, hundreds of invisible hands helping her up, pulling her towards the others who had long freed their feet of their slippers and were dancing barefoot in the grass. This was her place, where she'd lived nearly every summer of her life, surrounded by generations of the spiderweb of families that were as much a part of her as her limbs and fingers and toes. A space was made for her among the dancers, familiar faces whose smiles widened as they made room. Her body moved before she gave it permission, exhaling into this familiar rhythm, this particular beat. And then she was dancing, floating. Her hips synced with the ukuleles. In her throat, the words of the song caught with a sudden fierceness, a painful pang of homesickness she was only now aware she had. A great weight lifted off her chest. She wanted to shout with joy. Her voice cracked with emotion as she sang along to the words of the song being sung by the musicians at the picnic tables. How much she'd missed this, the comfort and safety in knowing. Headlights flashed across the grass yard of the beach, a blast of horns. The baby startled awake, began to cry. The sound was a bell toll, a spellbreaker. She sank back into herself. Things were different now. There were other considerations, other complications. The song was not over, but Laka dropped her hands and withdrew from the circle, now broken and confused. She left without saying goodbye. It would have been too hard to explain why. Two rotations around the sun before, there was no hi'i, and Laka was our princess. Our hopes and dreams, our Miss Aloha Hula, her picture in the paper like newly crowned royalty. The white velvet gown making her skin glow, the silver-gray hinahina flowers tucked in her mass of thick black curls, all of Hilo's pride filling the dark glint in her eyes. Laka and her father, Uncle George, taking up their usual table at Ken's for daddy-daughter waffles piled high with whipped cream, him fresh off the boat that had been out in the deep all night but was now resting in the small Wailoa harbor. He exhausted but caffeinated with pride, making sure everyone who walked in noticed her newly framed picture on the wall. Then poof, disappeared without a trace like an eel down the crack of a rock. We were sweeping the last of the festival's flowers from the stadium floor and nursing Mary Monarch hangovers when the news came that she'd gone to Maui. We peered at the sky, waiting for the blessings to rain down. But it had been dropless, barren and silent, a sign. She should have known better. By taking off, she'd said none of it mattered. Not the crown, not Miss Aloha Hula, not Keaukaha and her kuleana to it, bestowed upon her by her family's legacy. All Laka left behind was silence. The next morning, when Hulali realized Laka was gone, she stood on her porch and stared out across the ocean, the way a mother does when your heart exits your body and enters the world without you. We turned to her for answers, but got only a warning flash across her face.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.